Cryptography is the art of writing or solving codes and has roots that extend back thousands of years. One of the simplest forms of encryption are substitution codes, early codes that operated by replacing a letter of the alphabet with another letter or symbol. Clever as these types of codes can be, they are all vulnerable to attacks using frequency analysis. This attack is built around the frequency with which letters typically appear in a given language. Sherlock Holmes takes advantage of this attack to break the dancing men code.
Well, you see, the rules which guide us in deciphering all secret writing depend on the fact that E is the most common letter in the English language. So you see, we were very fortunate that Mrs. Cupid's name was LC, and that it featured in the second message, which gave us not only the E, but the L, the S, and the I.
One proposed solution to the problem of frequency analysis attacks was the development of the Vigenere cipher, first described by Giovanni Battista Bellasso in the year 1553. The cipher was considered unbreakable for over three centuries. So let's talk about how this unbreakable cipher works and how we could break it. The Vigenere cipher revolves around using a keyword or combination of letters to determine how the letters in your message should be changed. Each letter in the secret key corresponds to a number starting with A being 0 and Z being 25, which instructs a shift of the amount to a letter in the message. This is best illustrated by an example. Let's let blueberry be our secret key, and say the message we want to encrypt is the first few lines of the B movie. The key indicates a shifting pattern of 1, 11, 20, 4, 1, 4, 17, 17, 24. So the first letter of our message should be shifted one letter down the alphabet, sending A to B. Then C is shifted by 11 places, sending it to N. The next C is shifted 20 places, becoming W. And so on, we go shifting each letter the number of times indicated by our key. The key would be repeated as many times as necessary until the entire message is encrypted. Notice how the E's in B, the most common letter in the English language, are encrypted differently each time the word occurs. This strength made the Vigenere cipher more resilient to the standard type of frequency analysis that Sherlock Holmes used to break the dancing men code, and why it was considered unbreakable for just over three centuries. For my friend that has a secret key, decrypting my message is as simple as shifting each letter of the encoded text back the amount indicated by the key. B would send B back one space to A, L sends N back 11 spaces to C, and so on. Now that you know how to use this cipher and have likely already imagined multiple very important instances to use it, let's talk about how to break it. While the message is not all being shifted the same amount, there are patterns that can be exploited. For example, every 9 characters, our key starts over, so every 9th letter of the message was shifted the same amount. If we took the encrypted message, or ciphertext, and grouped the letters by every 9th, we would end up with 9 groups where every letter in the group has been shifted the same amount. So standard frequency analysis done within these groups would be quite effective at identifying common letters, especially in long messages. But the trick that made this cipher so secure was that the key could be any length. How could we know how many letters to skip before adding to our group? The trick is coincidences. Anytime a specific letter or pair of letters in the message coincidentally falls under the same location in the key, it will get shifted the same amount, and we will get the same result appearing in the ciphertext. For example, the B at the beginning of our key shifts the letter A in the message to B. This happens on the first and the sixth use of our key. Searching for these coincidences can give someone with no knowledge of the secret key a clue as to what the length might be, as the distances between the coincidences are multiples of the key length. There are multiple ways to identify where these coincidences occur, and a quick online search will yield various programs designed to do so or show you how to write your own Python code to accomplish it. But even without the help of these tools, you could do the following technique on paper or on a spreadsheet. First, take the ciphertext and list it twice with the second iteration shifted one space. Now any coincidences that occur one space apart will line up vertically. Shifting the ciphertext again will help us to spot coincidences that occur two spaces apart, and so on. Shifts that have a high number of coincidences are strong candidates to either be the length of the key or a multiple of it. For example, the repeated M and Y in our ciphertext 9 spaces apart makes 9 a strong candidate to either be the length of the key or a multiple of it. Once you have a good guess for the key length, you can sort the ciphertext into groups and perform a stratified frequency analysis. By looking at the frequency at which letters are occurring within each individual group, and comparing those to the frequencies we find on average in the English language. Frequency analysis done on these groups is very effective due to the fact that once you identify what any of the characters were originally shifted from, the entire group was shifted that same amount by the same part of the secret key, so you can decode the message an entire group at a time. Again, this could be done by hand, but there are also multiple programs online that can streamline this process, and even have nifty visuals for the frequency of letters that we're looking to match. For example, on this program, the green bars represent the frequency with which each letter occurs in the English language. Then after selecting a key size to investigate, and based on the coincidences we found, we would use 9, the program sort can sort the ciphertext into groups of every 9th character. We can then compare the frequency of letters in a given group represented by the blue bars. The group we were currently looking at began with the 3rd character in our ciphertext and every 9th following character. Looking for a match in the frequency patterns, the letter Y in this group of ciphertext is a good candidate for the letter E, which would indicate that the group was shifted by 20 spaces, making the 3rd letter of our key U. Following this process with each group, we can break the encryption and discover the letters in the secret key one by one. With modern-day computers and algorithms, Vigenere ciphers now can be broken very quickly, which is why it's no longer considered a secure encryption method. Although with one modification, we can get an encryption method that is truly unbreakable. If the secret key used was the same length as the message being sent, and ideally composed of a random string of characters, there would be no repetition of the key to give way to the coincidences we used to break the Vigenere. This kind of cipher is called a one-time pad, appropriately named because so long as the secret key is never used again, there's no way to break this cipher. A malicious eavesdropper's best chance would be to randomly generate keys and apply them to a message. The chances of success with this method are statistically improbable. Although considered unbreakable, one-time pads do have their weaknesses. Other than only being able to be used once, transporting a secret key the same length, or even longer, than any message you'd like to send is essentially the same problem as sending the message securely in the first place. Digital versions of one-time pad ciphers have been used by nations for critical diplomatic and military communication, but the problems of securely communicating keys make them impractical for most applications. Can you think of some reasons why one-time pads would become vulnerable if used even just twice? Let us know in the comments. And if you feel up to it, take a crack at breaking the encryption on the message on the screen. Comment below if you figured it out. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.